India's central bank announcing a surprise interest rate hike today. It's the first hike in more than a year, adding to concern that the world's second most populous country will not successfully withstand the inflation pressures. Still, our next guest says that of all the big countries out there, the most investment potential is still in India. Here with his insights, William Nobrega, founder and CEO of the Conrad Group. He is also author of Riding the Indian Tiger, Understanding Indian, the world's fastest growing market. All right, appreciate your being with us. Now, big picture, you're positive on India, but right now it's got to be concerning because you look at India and this economy that they're trying to grow and these subsidies that they have in place to help people that can't afford things get things and make the economy bigger, and they're running a budget deficit. It seems like an explosive situation.
Well, inflation is a concern for I think the global economy, but when you have a country with 300 or 400 million people living on a dollar a day, it takes on added sense of urgency. I do think the government is actually doing the right things. They're tightening the and I do expect that actually oil prices and food prices will moderate in the third and fourth quarter. Having said that, I think the real story for India is some of these next wave industries. You know, you see a convergence in India between the new consumer, infrastructure, environment, technology, and all those investments in infrastructure are just coming online now. So we haven't put that into the picture, and that's why we remain quite bullish on India for the long term.
And you are an author, you are also an investor. You've got $2 billion to put to work, so you're not just telling people what to do, you're actually doing it yourself. Are you putting money in India right now?
India is our preferred location. Brazil is second, but we see India as a long-term play. It's at the beginning of a 30-year run. We're more defensive in looking at these next wave industries, companies verticals like media and entertainment, distribution logistics, private education. Those type of things are actually going to continue to grow regardless of inflationary pressures.
Now, are those, when you look at India, you're traveling there, it's amazing, right? Because a lot of the companies that operate there successfully are Indian. Right? I mean, there's not it's opening to the outside world, but your big consumer products companies are not Procter & Gamble, right? They're Indian companies. So when you talk about private education or infrastructure, how do you play that? Are these names you've never heard of that trade in India? Are these big U.S. companies?
Currently, they're mostly Indian companies, and you're right. One of the reasons we like India so much is that it's a very entrepreneurial society. You have a Silicon Valley mindset. Many of the companies that are going public or are public there are very transparent, well-managed, and I think that that gives India an edge over some of its neighbors, i.e. China. Mm-hmm. You are seeing more investment by U.S. companies corporate-wise.
Right.
You're going to see more tie-ups, joint ventures, minority equity positions, which will strengthen the Indian company as well. So we see that as a net positive. But you're right, the majority of the plays are Indian plays right now.
Which is unusual. It's not always, in many countries, even in the BRICS, it's not always that way. And on the entrepreneur point, someone from India told me the other day a number that was amazing, 33 million entrepreneurs in India. Obviously, you could define that any way you want, but it's a lot of people. I mean, when you talk about an entrepreneurial culture, it comes down to, though, India and China. Now, they're not at war. They're not necessarily competitors in every way. But if you had to choose, why do you pick India over China?
Well, I think that the democratic institutions in India, while sloppy in the short term, give it a long-term competitive advantage long-term. And I think Indian entrepreneurs, you know, they have survived and succeeded without the support of the state. China, you end up partnering with the state. For Indian companies, they're very dynamic. They, you know, when the rupee was appreciating, what did they do? Well, they used it to go out on acquisition spree. So you see Tata acquiring Ford and Land Rover. Suzlon Energy is now the fifth largest energy producer. So you're seeing some very dynamic, well-run international brands developing out of India, and that's why we like it.
All right. Well, thank you very much, William. We appreciate it. Good luck with your book.